Good morning. Welcome to Westover Baptist Church and Worship Service. Thank you for being with us today. We're so grateful we could worship together even as we are not in the same space. We feel that God has His richest blessings for you as you view this service. We invite you to download the Worship Service Bulletin located on our homepage. Also, if you have a specific prayer request, please go to our homepage and click on the prayer button on the right-hand side of the page. We would love to pray for you, so we encourage you to make use of this opportunity and allow us to serve you in this way. Now, wherever you find yourself in life, we want this to be a worship experience you can depend on for receiving inspiration, encouragement, and support. Enjoy your worship service with us today, and God bless you.
Come together for our first hymn this morning, We Will Glorify, number 213.
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before His throne. We will worship Him in righteousness. We will worship Him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord above the universe. All praise to Him we give. Alleluia to the King of Kings. Alleluia to the Lamb. Alleluia to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am.
We have a few announcements. The COVID-19 pandemic has certainly changed each of our lives. And one of the ways it has made a significant change all around the world and here in the Arlington community is increasing the need for food assistance. We have partnered for a number of years with the Arlington Food Assistance Center, and typically we have food drives at least 2 times per year. The need is greater, so we ask that you join us in supporting our neighbors in need and drop off canned goods and non-perishable foods that will be donated to the Arlington Food Assistance Center. The drop-off location is at the church, and the donation box is inside of door 2 on the Patrick Henry Drive side of the building. We thank you for your support. It is a joy to announce the celebration service of the 80th anniversary of Westover Baptist Church. We'd love for you to join us for the celebration. So we ask that you mark your calendars for Sunday, September 27th at 11 a.m. You will be able to attend virtually or join us on site at the church. We will also celebrate Westover's homecoming. It will be a great time to look back over the blessings of the past year and forward into the future with anticipation for what the Lord is going to do in the year to come. Details can be found on the church website. Thank you.
Hello, boys and girls. I want to invite you to our Backyard Bible Club on August the 29th. We're going to have 2 Zoom sessions, one at 9 a.m. and another at 10:15 a.m. If you had fun with us during our vacation Bible school as Knights of the North Castle, we're going to have even more fun in our Backyard Bible Club. We will participate in fun activities, Bible games, laugh and play. Then we're also going to pray for the upcoming school year. So ask Mom or Dad to go to our church website and register you for our Backyard Bible Club. I know that you will have fun, and I'm looking forward to seeing you there. It's just around the corner, our Friends and Family Sunday. Every fifth Sunday, we roll out the carpet to invite our family members who don't normally worship with us, our friends, our neighbors, co-workers, to worship with us, and then also to share a meal. This Friends and Family Sunday is going to be very special. We're going to have lunch, fellowship, and trivia games, and also conduct our mid-year business meeting. So please mark your calendars, August the 30th at 12:30 on Zoom. You can get the details at our church website. It'll be our Friends and Family Sunday.
Although we're not able to be on campus for worship service and for our other ministry activities, we do have ongoing expenses to maintain the building, support staff, and provide community support. We are grateful to those who have been able to continue to give during this time. It has been very helpful to us. We are providing several ways that you can give. You can give online or through our church website. If you go to our website, there is a button that is marked Give on the right-hand side of the homepage. You can click that button and you are asked for particular information about your gift. You can set up your gift as a one-time gift or a recurring gift and then provide your banking information. Using your mobile phone, you can give by texting. Send a text to the number 73256. And then, in the body of the text message, you would type in capital W, capital C, capital A, lowercase r, lowercase l, and the amount of your gift and hit enter. Then a screen will come up and ask you for your banking or credit card information. You may also continue to mail your gift to the church. The mail is monitored daily, or you may drop your gift off to the church and put it in the church office mail slot, which is the door between the flagpoles facing Patrick Henry Drive. Some of you may take advantage of online banking through your own bank and have the bank send a check through the mail. You may use any of these methods to provide your gift, and we sincerely appreciate your support. Thank you.
Our scripture lesson this morning is titled, God Does Big Things with What People See as Small. It comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 1 through 3 and 5 through 10, and we're reading from the New Living Translation.
After this, Jesus crossed over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Sea of Tiberias. A huge crowd kept following him wherever he went because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick.
Then Jesus climbed a hill and sat down with his disciples around him. Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, "Where can we buy bread to feed all these people?"
He was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." Then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up.
"There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with this huge crowd?" "Tell everyone to sit down," Jesus said. So they all sat down on the grassy slopes. The men alone numbered about 5,000. We ask God to bless the reading of his word. Our next hymn today is number 447, Trust and Obey. Please join together.
Glory is shed on our way. us to his goodwill. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he does richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God.
Reverend Michael Youngblood, pastor of Westover Baptist Church. Welcome. I'm glad that you're here with us this week. The Bible says, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. And he has been good. No matter what situations we may have encountered, no matter what we have gone through, God still has been good and his love has not changed. I hope that you will take note of the announcements that have been shared with you earlier. And I would also like to say I thank you for your support of this ministry. We need your financial support to maintain this ministry, to be able to bring this broadcast to you, to share with you. And I will just ask you to drop us a note. I would love to hear from you. I would love to hear how our ministry is making a difference in your life. I hope that you will take note of the announcements that were shared with you earlier. We have a number of great things that are very near on our calendar. Our 80th anniversary is just around the corner. God has blessed this church and this ministry to serve and to help our community for over 80 years. Our Backyard Bible Study Club will be launching next week. I hope you'll go to our website and look at the details and join us. Also, next Sunday, we will have a blessing for the backpacks as we pray for our children as they're about to enter this new school year. God is able to protect us from whatever danger may come our way. And we seek him in prayer. We seek his blessings as these young people endeavor to learn and to move forward in their life. We are a praying church. By that, I mean we seek God in prayer to thank him for his blessings, to seek his guidance and his direction, to ask for his power and reign in our world and in our life individually. We have a place on our website if you would like us to join you in a prayer request, where you can let us know those concerns and needs that you may have. And we'll gladly and confidentially join you in prayer as we lift you up to God. God honors the prayers of the saints of his people who love him when they come together in prayer, seeking him and petitioning him. So again, if you have a prayer request, I ask, won't you leave it on our website? There's a special place where we can join you in prayer. Now, as we come for our corporate prayer, won't you join me, please? Our Father who art in heaven, Lord, you have not forgotten us, and we are certainly not out of your sight or out of your love or out of your care or out of your protection. And so, dear Father, we first say thank you for the many blessings that you have given us, a reasonable portion of health and strength, sources of income, dear Father, food, clothing, and shelter. And while some may be considered these things basic things, Lord, we say thank you. And we know in the Word, in the Bible, it says every good and perfect gift comes from above. I pray, Lord, for those who are bereaved, that have recently lost loved ones, that still that emptiness spot in someone's heart where a loved one or a close friend is no longer with us. You said that you would fill that void, that you would give us peace, that you would wipe away every tear. So we pray and ask for your consolation. Dear Father, where we are facing challenges, challenges that are too big for us to comprehend, let alone believe that we can overcome, you are able. There is no problem, no situation, nothing that has happened that you can't handle. And so, Father, whatever our concerns are, whatever our worries are, we lay them at your feet in our prayer, dear Father, and we leave them there with you, not to worry about them anymore, knowing that you do hear and you answer prayer. We pray, Lord, for your intervention in the pandemic that is sweeping the world, our nation, and our community, dear Father. We pray for a cure that will soon be found, Lord, and Lord, that you could restore us back to a sense of normalcy. But even in this time, even in this trial, Lord, help us to show and demonstrate our faith and our trust in you, because you haven't left us. You haven't abandoned us. And I know that you will take us through even COVID-19. We ask these blessings in the name of your Son, the Christ Jesus. Amen. Won't you join me in the Gospel of John, the 6th chapter? I would like to walk through this chapter today with you as we see and learn something about the ministry of Jesus and what it means to us and for us. That's John, the 6th chapter. We're going to begin at the first verse. Our focus will be the 9th verse, if you can jot that down. All this month, we have been talking from a theme of your mission, should you decide to accept. And the point being that we have challenges. God calls us to do something. He doesn't call us just to be sidelined Christians, to sit in the pews or to just kick back and watch life go by. But he calls us and he even challenges us to test our faith, to see our commitment to him. And so today, your mission, should you decide to accept, is to give Jesus your lunch. But join me. You'll see where I'm going with this. There in John, in the 6th chapter, beginning at the first verse, it says, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Now, this is one of the things that I've grown to learn and better understand since I've traveled to that area and had an opportunity to see the Sea of Galilee and even be on the Sea of Galilee. It's actually a lake. Look at the picture I'm showing you. The Sea of Galilee is actually a large lake, and it had two names. Actually, even is a third name. But because it was in the area of Tiberias, It was often referred to as also the Sea of Tiberias. But this is the Sea of Galilee. And this is the area where Jesus made his home, in Capernaum. And so much of his work, much of his ministry took place around the Sea of Galilee, around this lake. And we'll see that. And so it says here then, after these things, Jesus had healed great multitudes. They were following him. He had raised the dead, helped the lame to walk, given vision to the blind. And so the multitudes followed him for that and also to hear the word of God. The Bible says in the second verse, then a great multitude followed him because they saw his signs which he performed on those who were diseased. Jesus came healing the sick and raising the dead. The third verse says that Jesus went up on the mountain and there he sat with his disciples, a natural amphitheater where he could speak to the people and they would hear his teaching. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing the great multitude coming towards him, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? We serve a God who cares about us completely. Not just to say I'm saying a prayer for you and I hope the best for you. He recognizes our needs, that we need food and clothing and shelter. And he provides for that. And so here now he asks his disciple, Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? A great multitude. I said earlier, Jesus will test our faith. It's not to make us fail, but to show us what he can do if we will trust him. If I didn't trust a chair, I wouldn't sit down in it. But because I have faith and confidence that it'll hold my weight, I'll sit down. If we have faith and trust in God, we can rest on him. We can lean on him, knowing that he does hear and he does answer our prayers. The sixth verse explains what I just said about Philip. But he said this to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Don't you know in our situations and whatever we may be facing, Jesus already has the answer? Why should we worry? Why should we fret? Jesus already has it worked out. The seventh verse. Now here comes the test. Here's Philip's response. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them that every one of them may have a little. Philip was not thinking of enough. I'm not preaching health and welfare and prosperity, but if we ask God to supply our needs, he's not cheap. He's not chintzy. He's not just going to barely make it by, but he's going to provide enough for us. Will we have that type of faith and confidence? Or would it be like Philip to say, even if we could buy it, it would barely meet what's needed? One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there is a lad who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Again, Jesus is testing them. And look how they're coming short of their faith. But what are they among so many? 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, a meal for a poorer person. This wasn't a meal of luxury. And this is a lad, a young man. And Peter says, we got that, but what's that compared to all of these people? Do you have situations and challenges in your life? And do you mistakenly look at them and say, how is this going to be resolved? How is this going to be fixed? Who's going to take care of this? Without saying, Lord, this is yours. He's already told us that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. If we ask anything in his will, he does hear and answer our prayer. He says if he is that loving father that can do better than an earthly father to provide our needs, why would we worry? The 10th verse, then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in numbers of about 5,000 men. 5,000 men. This doesn't give count to the women and children, but 5,000 men. This miracle is spoken of and written of in all of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And one of the Gospels says that he told them to sit down in groups of 50. So there's over 100 groups of men that are sat there, some 5,000 men, also with women and children. The 11th verse says, and Jesus took the loaves. When he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those who were sitting. Likewise, the fish, as much as they wanted. Don't miss that, my friends. This is Jesus, the Son of God, but yet he could give thanks for what he had. Then the disciples make it clear that these five loaves of barley bread and these two fish were insignificant. I mean, not a drop in the bucket to feed 5,000 men plus women and children. They had discounted. But look at what Jesus does. Doesn't he give us an example of what we should do? What some may consider to be meager means or nothing or not enough. Jesus gave thanks for it. I hope you catch that. The Son of God, to me, is saying to us, whatever we have, give thanks for it because God can bless it and it will go farther than we could ever think or imagine. The 12th verse says, so when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain so that nothing is lost. He gave it to his disciples and they began to distribute it. Five barley loaves and two fish. And it continued to be divided and provided for 5,000 men and women and children. What do you think God can do in our life if we would trust him? And so I have three thoughts from what we have just read and gone through. One, Jesus had compassion on the people. Two, he did not allow the disciples to influence him when they discounted the young man's lunch. And then finally, he gave thanks. So how can this be meaningful to you and I? First of all, let's look at what Jesus did. He had compassion. So first of all, we should know that Jesus cares about us. He's not indifferent. He doesn't see us coming and say, oh, you know, go on and do something else. I don't have time today. I don't want to be bothered. But he cares for you. He loves you. And he knows the situations you face and that you are going to encounter. And he's there to love you and to provide a way. Then it says that he did not allow the disciples to discourage him. You can have friends, family members, and relatives and coworkers. I don't care who. They may say, I wouldn't trust Jesus. Nobody's going to fix this. Nobody's going to work this out. But what will your faith say? Where will you stay? Will you trust Jesus? When some say it's not enough, it'll never work, it'll never be adequate, will you trust Jesus to make it adequate, to make it work? He's able. He is able. And then finally, as I look at my final note, It says that he gave thanks. No matter what situation you find yourself in, give thanks. Praise God. Praise him to deliver you, to bring you through, to provide for what you need. That's what faith is about. It's not what we can see, not what we have, not what we know, but it's trusting God at his word. To trust God to be who and what he says he is. He can make miracles happen. He can make a way out of no way. That's our God. Jesus had compassion. Jesus did not allow others to discourage him and lose his faith. And then Jesus gave thanks. My brothers and my sisters, have compassion on your friends and your neighbors and for those who may have less than you. Remember, Jesus said to a group one time, he says, when I was naked, you clothed me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was in jail, you came to see me and visit me. And they said, Lord, when were you in jail and we came to see you? When were you hungry and we fed you? Or when were you naked, Jesus, and we clothed you? Jesus said, what you have done to the most insignificantly important person, you have done to me. So let us have compassion for our brothers and sisters to share and to help others. That's how God will bless us. And then don't let anyone discourage you, or as the words of a song say, don't let no one turn you around. Trust in God. Not for what you know, not for what you can do, but trust him for what he can do. And then, finally, always give thanks. Paul said, I've learned to be satisfied whether I have a lot or I have a little, whether I have food to eat or whether I don't. I've learned to trust God, for he has provided for my needs. I hope you will accept this mission. Give Jesus your small amount, your lunch, that lad's lunch, to trust him to take it and make it something that will be possible to feed thousands, to benefit thousands, to help many others. If you trust him, he will not disappoint you. Trust him. Only trust him just now. One of the ways to show your trust and your faith in Jesus is to make him your Lord and your Savior. What does that mean? To be your Lord means you trust his guidance for your life, his will, his way, not your way, and your Savior in that he provides salvation to those who will trust him and obey him. Won't you pray this prayer with me? To receive salvation of Jesus Christ. Dear Lord, I repent of my sins and my transgressions. Forgive me, Lord, when I have been disobedient to what you desired for my life. Jesus, I recognize and believe in my heart that you are the Son of God, that you died on Calvary's cross for my sins. And that because you paid the price by me inviting you into my life, I will not pay the price for my sins. Jesus, I believe that you rose the third day from the dead. And because you live, I will also live. Because you live, I know that I have a place with you throughout eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. My friends, if you have prayed that prayer, if you have given Jesus your life, if you have made him your Lord and Savior, what a wonderful thing. Your life will never be the same. He didn't, and I'm not promising you a bed of roses, but I'm promising you that he will always make a way. That's the promise he gave us. He'll always be there. Just trust him. God bless you. call me, email me, and let me know about your decision. I would love to share some words of encouragement to you along this Christian journey. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we close our service, know that God's love, His peace, and strength are available to you, and He will keep you. He will keep you from all danger, hurt, and harm. He will allow His angels to watch over you. Just trust Him. May God bless you, and may God keep you until we meet again.